For the lesson today is Romans 4, 13 to 21. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the inheritance of the law who are to be heirs, faith is null, and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest by grace and be guaranteed to all descendants, not only to the inheritance of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham, for he is the father of all of us. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations, in the presence of God, in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead, and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said. So numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old. And when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb, no distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God. But he grew strong in his faith, and he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words, "it was reckoned to him," were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification. The word of the Lord. Please stand for the reading of the gospel.
The Holy Gospel for this morning is a reading from St. Mark, the 8th chapter. Glory to you, Lord. Then Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. Jesus said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, Jesus rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of being of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. And you may be seated. Well, grace and peace be unto you from God our Father and from our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We feel a little sympathy for Peter this morning, don't we? I mean, if we put ourselves in his shoes, how would you like the Savior of the world to call you Satan, right? To call you a little devil. We know that Jesus has called Peter other words in the Bible. Jesus has called Peter the rock on which he will build his church. But in today's Gospel, Jesus calls Peter Satan. That's not exactly a promotion, is it? To go from the rock to Satan. So we feel sympathy for poor Peter, and he is kind of the Rodney Dangerfield, right, of the Gospel. Peter doesn't always come off so well. He doesn't, Rodney, maybe I'm dating myself, Rodney Dangerfield, remember him? He's the one that says, I get no respect. That's right, yeah. And Peter doesn't get a lot of respect. Listen to the gospel again. Jesus began to teach his disciples that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, stripes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. Jesus said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. So let's explore that for a while this morning. Peter's rebuke of Jesus. What does that mean? Well, first of all, we probably need a definition, because rebuke isn't a word that is used commonly, right, in everyday language. I mean, how many times have you used the word rebuke lately? We don't use that word very often. It's not part of our daily vocabulary. And the word that our scripture translates as rebuke is most often used in the Gospel of Mark. When Jesus commands forces that go against him, Mark tells us that Jesus rebukes them. So, for instance, the evil spirits, that the demonic spirits that have taken possession over people's bodies, Mark will tell us that Jesus rebukes those evil spirits or those demons. Or when there was a great storm that rose on the Sea of Galilee, the picture that is depicted on our altar scene, when the storm arose to threaten the very well-being of Jesus' disciples, the winds came up, the great waves, Mark tells us that Jesus rebuked the waves, and the waves were sustained, right? The storm ceased upon Jesus' rebuke. So evil spirits, the wind, those are the two examples. And there's a sense of rebuking in which there is an exertion of power over the one for whom is being rebuked. So what other words might we use here for rebuke to make this maybe a little more user-friendly for us in today's world, in today's language? Well, here are a few. Peter told off Jesus. To tell off is another word that we could use for rebuke. Or have you ever heard of the word diss, right? Peter dissed Jesus. In that, the word diss means to dismiss. Right? That's what diss means. It's just a little more hip or a trendy word. To diss somebody is to dismiss them. Another way we can understand rebuke is to scold them or to give a good talking to. That is rebuke. So Peter rebuked Jesus. But to be fair, let's try to put ourselves in the shoes of Peter. He and the other disciples have been invited to follow in the footsteps of this incredible man, Jesus. His astonishing work, his charismatic and compelling presence. Peter and the other disciples were able to spend every day with this Jesus. And Peter goes from being a fisherman, nobody, to being the first lieutenant of this miracle-working man, Jesus, who was a brilliant public speaker. And he was attracting all of these, he was popular, he was attracting all of these crowds and followers. And to this fact, Jesus was attracting the followers, because Jesus was not only speaking about what was important to Jesus, but he was speaking about and to what was important to God. So Jesus' words and Jesus' actions were not just Jesus' own words and actions, but they were the words and actions of God. They were of the reign of God, or of the kingdom of God. So this is about God's kingdom and God's reign. So just imagine for yourself living every day with Jesus, walking beside this Jesus, the Son of God, who was teaching and proclaiming and healing. Imagine getting up and having Jesus at your side. Imagine every meal that you ate by Jesus' side. Imagine being taught by this Jesus every single day of your life. And that you weren't just being taught about Jesus, but you were being taught about God and what is important to God and about God's reign and God's kingdom. And then quickly, after all of this important work of Jesus, his teachings and healings and proclaiming God's ultimate reign, Jesus begins to talk about torture, right? And suffering. And his own death. Not just as a hypothetical situation or a possibility, but as a requirement of his job and of his work that Jesus has set out to do. So no wonder Peter in Mark's gospel, no wonder he pulls Jesus aside and begins to rebuke Jesus. And we don't know what he said in rebuking Jesus, but something was said along the lines of, no, there should not be suffering for you, Jesus. There should not be death for you, Jesus. There should not be a crucifixion for you, Jesus, because you are the very power of God among us. So Peter says no to all of this. And Peter's words, Peter's no, is not only a no to Jesus, but it is a no to God. Jesus is having none of it. So he calls Peter Satan. He calls Peter Satan. He looks at Peter in his eyes and he says to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. Get behind me." Maybe to understand that, we have to understand a little bit about Satan and how Satan shows up in the world, how Satan shows up in the Gospels, and in understanding that, we can understand how Satan shows up in our own lives. So we need a little study on the word Satan. We need to take a little class, like Satan 101, this morning. And to understand, when Satan is spoken of in the Old Testament, it is a Hebrew word. Satan is simply a Hebrew word that means the one who tempts. Satan is a tempter. And the tempter in the Old Testament is actually a part of God's heavenly court. Satan is part of God's heavenly realm. And he functions to prod the Almighty, to test kind of God's worldview. That's the point of Satan in the Old Testament. As an example, we see Satan pushing God to question the righteousness of his servant Job. You remember Job in the Old Testament. If you read the beginning of Job, we have Satan, who is part of God's heavenly court, and he is testing God's understanding of the righteousness of Job. God has declared Job to be righteous, and Satan is saying, "Are you sure about that, God? Let's see how righteous Job really is." But then once we get to the New Testament, something changes radically. Instead of Satan being one skeptical member on God's team, on God's heavenly court, he abruptly appears to be on the other side. Satan is on the anti-God side. In the New Testament, the devil's job is no longer to help God to see things clearly. Now, God's job, or Satan's job, is to mess up the vision of the people. It is to mess up how we see things clearly. That is how Satan is used in the New Testament, to tempt us, to seduce us, to ensnare us, to leave God's team, you might say, and join Satan's team. So it seems clear that here Jesus is employing this second usage of Satan. Peter is a kind of Satan, perhaps just a little one, for the role he is playing in trying to tempt Jesus away from who God created Jesus to be and the mission that God gave Jesus to do. So I think every day of our lives, each of us, we have little devils that try to come near us and among us to taunt us and to ensnare us, to move us away from that word that we learned today. What was the word? Covenant. To take us away, to ensnare us away from God's covenant among us. That is the role of those little devils that kind of dance in and around our heads to try to ensnare us or to tempt us to move away from that covenant that God has already established with us in calling us His very own and His very beloved. That's Satan's work among us. So I wonder what those little things are for you. The things that tempt you away from God's path, or perhaps more insidiously, what are those things and situations that convince us that we are not able to be the people that we want to be in this life? That we compromise. The things that damage our best hopes for ourselves. Those little moments that infect our minds and doubt, and they tell us, well, you can't do that, or you can't be that in this life. Those are our little devils. Those are our little Satans that come to attack us. And jokingly, sometimes we say, well, the devil made me do it, right? I mean, we sometimes say that jokingly, but all joking aside, I believe it returns again and again to the same starting place. And that starting place is the place where that covenant has been established with us and maintained with us in our baptism. Can the sense of God's love somehow saturate us and soak us through to help us stare down those little devils, those little Satans that call for us in this life? In the service of holy baptism that we just had for Briella, we declared that we will renounce the devil and all of his empty promises. Do you remember doing that? The pastor says, do you renounce the devil and all of his empty promises? And what do you say? We renounce them, right? We renounce them. It sounds a little bit, that word renounce sounds a little bit like rebuke, doesn't it? We will renounce the work of the devil in our lives. We will rebuke the work of the devil that takes us from who God wants me to be and who God has called me to be in this life. And I will stay forever on that path that God has for me. I will maintain that path. I will maintain that walk. I will maintain that light that has been given to me at the time of my baptism, and I will seek to declare that light to others. I will not listen to the work of those little devils. I renounce them. I renounce them. And I will continue to renounce them. And when we do that, Jesus turns to us and tells us to take up our cross so that we might follow Him once again. Amen. We'll receive our word.